RO him. Detail a purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout journey through this present date. This school was established as a result of the divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year 1931. We were incorporated in the state of California in the year 1958. Since that time, we have established branch schools throughout the United States, Canada, and various countries of the world. The Albuquerque branch was established in 1986. In this school, we use the true, correct, and original name and title of the Father, the Word, Son, and the Holy Spirit as contained in the original Hebrew text. The correct name of our Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The correct title of the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted by God. The name of the Holy Spirit, whether manifested in or out of a physical body, is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus. Lord and God are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, who is filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8 and 5 that there are Lord's many and God's many. But we now know that each Lord and each God must have a name. Elohim is a title also, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. That means that Elohim is a title that our Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part and a good dictionary or encyclopedia will prove that neither the Hebrew, the Greek, or the Latin languages have characters or letters in their alphabet that would produce a sound that is made by the letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1400 years after the death of the Messiah. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings of the true and original name of our Heavenly Father and the Son. Christ is a title just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit, and in his state he is inscrutable and incomprehensible. He's the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh in his pure spirit state symbolized on this chart as a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. We've drawn this cloud all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh knew that man would not be able to perceive of him in this pure spirit state. So he took on shape and form right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a super incorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. This form can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Later on, the self, same spirit, manifested himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Joshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now, there's only one name given up to salvation, and we all must know that name. So the simple yet intelligent question that we should all ask ourselves is, just what was the name of the Savior during the time that he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of these names and title may be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach about the divine pattern of the universe. It is called the divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh had delivered the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt, he called Moses atop Mount Sinai and showed him the tabernacle pattern in a vision. Yahweh instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. The pattern consists of the most holy place, the holy place, and the court round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. We go about in this school to show proof how that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and the function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. The primary constitutional objectives or aims of this school are as follows. The first is to help you find and know Yahweh, or Elohim, as he really is and as he actually exists. Second is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah, without the distinction of race, creed, nationality, sex, caste, or color. The third is to investigate the unexplained spirit law, or the so-called law of nature and the powers latent in man. The fourth is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religion, psychology, philosophy, and both modern practical and occult science. Fifth is to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. The sixth is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. The seventh is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan, and his demons operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensation of time. The eighth is to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith which is once delivered unto the sons or children of Yahweh. The ninth is to make known that Yahweh from the very beginning ordained that there is none other name given among man whereby man can be saved, saving in the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace, and our slogan is to speak the truth. We will have this morning's class dedicated with a prayer by Dr. Schaff, followed by music and a scripture lesson be read by Dr. Tony Hoffman, which is Matthew 27th and 28th chapter, both chapters.
Opportunity to be here once again to see this great gospel that's been set before us. We just ask that you would open our hearts and our minds to be receptive to those truths that we'll be hearing today, that we may continue to grow in the knowledge and wisdom of this gospel, and to know you as you really are and how you actually exist, and you know your son, Yahshua the Messiah. The only name that was given for salvation. We just thank you for the many blessings of knowing this gospel, and especially the blessing of discernment, that we may know when someone speaks the truth or a lie. We just thank you and praise you and give you all the honor and the glory, for we ask the name of Yahshua Messiah. Everyone say,
Amen.
Say good morning to everybody.
Good morning.
I'm going to be reading Matthew, the 27th and the 28th chapter, and I will be reading out of a Holy Name Bible containing the Holy Name version of the Old and New Testament. Please be prepared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts, revised by the late A.B. Trainer of the Scripture Research Association. Matthew 27. When the morning was come, all the chief priests and elders of the people took counsel against Yahshua to put him to death. And when they had bound him, they led him away and delivered him to Pontius Pilate, the governor. Then Judah, which had betrayed him, when he saw that he was condemned, repented himself, and brought again the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and elders, saying, I have sinned and that I have betrayed the innocent blood. And they said, What is that to us? See thou to that. And he cast down the pieces of silver in the temple and departed and went and hanged himself. And the chief priests took the silver pieces and said, It is not lawful for to put them into the treasury, because it is the price of blood. And they took counsel and bought with them the potter's field to bury strangers in. Wherefore, that field was called the field of blood unto this day. Then was fulfilled that which was spoken by Zechariah the prophet, saying, So they weighed out my reward, the 30 pieces of silver, the price of him that was valued, whom they of the children of Israel did value, and gave them for the potter's field, as Yahweh had appointed. And Yahshua stood before the governor, and the governor asked him, saying, Art thou the king of the Jews? And Yahshua said unto him, Thou sayest. And when he was accursed of the chief priests and elders, he answered nothing. Then said Pilate unto him, Hearest thou now how many things they witness against thee? And he answered him never a word, insomuch that the governor marveled greatly. Now at the feast the governor was wont to release unto the people a prisoner whom they would. And they had then a notorious prisoner called Barabba. Therefore, when they were gathered together, Pilate said unto them, Whom will ye that I release unto you, Barnabas or Joshua, which is called the Messiah? For he knew that for envy they had delivered him. Now he was set down on the judgment seat. His wife said unto him, saying, Have thou nothing to do with that just man? For I have suffered many things this day in a dream because of him. But the chief priests and elders persuaded the multitude that they should ask for Barabba and destroy Joshua. The governor answered and said unto them, Whether of the twain will thou I release unto you? They said, Barabba. Pilate said unto them, What shall I do then with Joshua, which is called the Messiah? They all say unto him, Let him be crucified. And the governor said, Why, what evil hath he done? But they cried out with even more, saying, Let him be crucified. When Joshua saw that he could prevail nothing, when Pilate saw that he could prevail nothing, but that rather a tumult was made, he took water and washed his hands before the multitude, saying, I am innocent of the blood of this just person. See, you do it. Then answered all the people and said, His blood be upon us and on our children. Then he released Barabba unto them, and when he had scourged Joshua, he delivered him to be crucified. Then the soldiers of the governor took Joshua into the common hall and gathered unto him the whole band of soldiers. And they stripped him and put him on a scarlet robe. And when they had planted a crown of thorns, they put it upon his head and a reed in his right hand. And they bowed the knee before him and mocked him, saying, Hail, King of the Jews! And they spit upon him and took the reed and smote him on the head. And after that they had mocked him, they took the robe off from him and put his own raiment on and led him away to be crucified. And as they came out, they found a man of Cyrene, Simon by name. Him they compelled to bear his cross. And when they had gone unto a place called Golgotha, a place of the skull, they gave him vinegar to drink, mingled with an opiate, and when he had tasted thereof, he would not drink. And they crucified him and parted his garments, casting lots, in fulfillment of that which was spoken by the prophet, that they part my garments among them and cast lots upon my vesture. And sitting down, they watched him there, and set up over his head his accusation, written, This is Joshua, the king of the Jews. Then were there two thieves crucified with him, one on the right hand and the other on the left. And they that passed by reviled him, wagging their heads and saying, Thou that destroyest the temple and buildest it in 3 days, save thyself. If thou be the son of Yahweh, come down from the cross. Likewise also the chief priest, mocking with the scribes and elders, said, He saved others. Himself he cannot save. If he be the king of Israel, let him now come down from the cross, and we will believe him. He trusted in Yahweh. Let him deliver him now, if he will have him. For he said, I am the son of Yahweh. The thieves also, which were crucified with him, cast the same in his teeth. Now from the sixth hour there was darkness over the land unto the ninth hour. And about the ninth hour Joshua cried with a loud voice, saying, Eli, Eli, sama sabachthani? That is to say, my El, why hast thou forsaken me? Some of them that stood there, when they had heard that, said, This man calleth for Elijah. And straightway one of them ran and took a sponge and filled it with vinegar and put it on a reed and gave it to him to drink. The rest said, Let us see whether Elijah will come to save him. Joshua, when he had cried again with a loud voice, yielded up the spirit. And behold, the veil of the temple was torn in twain from the top to the bottom, and the earth did quake and the rocks broke, and the graves were open, and many of the bodies of the son which slept arose and came out of the graves after his resurrection and went into the holy city and appeared to many. Now when the centurion and they that were with him watching Joshua saw the earthquake and those things that were done, they feared greatly, saying, truly this was the Son of the Most High. And many women were there beholding afar off, which followed Joshua from Galilee, ministering unto him. And among them which was Miriam Magdalene, and Miriam the mother of James and Joseph, and the mother of Zebedee's children. When the even was come, there came a rich man of Arimathea named Joseph, who also himself was Joshua's disciple. He went to Pilate and begged the body of Joshua. Then Pilate commanded the body to be delivered. And when Joseph had taken the body, he wrapped it in clean linen cloth and laid it in his own new tomb, which he had hewed out in the rock. And he rolled a great stone to the door of the sepulchre and departed. And there was Miriam Magdalene and the other Miriam sitting over against the sepulchre. Now the next day that followed the day of this preparation, the chief priests and Pharisees came together unto Pilate, saying, Sir, we remember that deceiver said, while he was yet alive, after 3 days I will rise again. Command therefore that the sepulchre be made sure until the third day be past, lest his disciples come by night and steal him away, and say unto the people, he is risen from the dead, so the last error shall be worse than the first. Pilate said unto them, ye have a watch, go your way, make it as sure as you can. So they went and made the sepulchre sure, sealing the stone and setting a watch. After the Sabbath was past, and after the day after the Sabbath began to dawn, came Miriam Magdalene and the other Miriam to see the sepulchre. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for the angel of Yahweh descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat upon it. His countenance was like lightning, and his raiment white as snow. And for fear of him, the keepers did shake and became as dead men. And the angel answered and said unto the woman, fear not ye, for I know that ye seek Joshua, whom was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen. And as he said, come, see the place where Joshua lay, and go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead. And behold, he goeth before you into Galilee. There shall ye see him. Lo, I have told you. And they departed quickly from the sepulchre with fear and with great joy, and did run to bring his disciples word. And as they went to tell his disciples, behold, Joshua met them, saying, peace be unto you. And they came and held him by his feet and worshipped him. Then said Joshua to them, be not afraid. Go tell my brethren that he go into Galilee, and there shall they see me. Now when they were going, behold, some of the watch came unto the city, and showed unto them the chief priests all the things that were done. And when they were assembled with the elders, and had taken counsel, they gave large money unto the soldiers, saying, say ye, his disciples came by night and stole them away while we slept. And if this come to the governor's ear, we will persuade him and secure you. So they took the money and did as they were taught. And this saying is commonly reported among the Jews unto this day. Then the 11 disciples went away into Galilee, into a mountain where Joshua had appointed them. And when they saw him, they worshipped him, even while some doubted. And Joshua came and spoke unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I had commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the age. I just read Matthew, the 27th and the 28th chapter.
We have a couple announcements. First, Dr. Paul Salas is kind of sick because he had a pacemaker installed. Mm-hmm. And then you have Dr. Sandra Smith. She had like an episode with her heart. She's at home, I guess, and resting. Maybe. I hope. That's not like she's going to go home. Dr. Margaret Pacescale will be attending the seminar in Chicago for the meeting Thursday. She'll be gone for a couple weeks, right? Basically. And any donations for the Treasury will be taken by Dr. Tony Hoffman. And our speaker this morning will be our dean, Dr. Fred Allen Jr.
See the sun today, but
right.
Anyhow, we'll talk to you about it. It'll be about the resurrection, about the Messiah, about the resurrection. I'm sorry I had to have all that chapter, those chapters read, but it's important because you're covering a lot of ground. And when Margaret Pacescale came over to the house the other day, Bib, I asked a question of them. I said, well, what the...
Loud. Please.
Yesterday when Mark Pacescale came over to the house and my wife was sitting there talking, I asked him a question about how did the... All scriptures, all. What did the scripture say about the Messiah's resurrection? What did it cover? About the Messiah's resurrection. And Margaret, she came up, she said, the whole law and prophets testify. Well, it's true, and that's true. And, you know, there's many things I think about these things, but. Here we have disputation in the class in the IDMR about going to the law and the prophets. And that's the whole core of this teaching is based on going to the law and the prophets testify of Yahshua Messiah. Yet still people don't want to do that. So anyhow, start thinking about the different things that's in the scripture that talk about the Messiah's death, burial, and resurrection. And sometimes we don't think about it, we don't always point these things out all the time concerning that. And so I had to do some of that, I'm going to do all of it now, because I found there's so much in the Bible that relates to that. I remember Dr. Kennedy saying the whole Bible from Genesis to Revelation is dealing with the death, burial, and resurrection of Yahshua Messiah. So I mean, you go the whole Bible that's telling, testifying to the Messiah. Now, let me see, I'm going to try to go this way. But, so many things. Oh, boy. Get me Matthew 12:28 and 29.
Matthew what?
Matthew 12:28-29.
That's a movie.
Matthew 12:28.
If y'all don't hear me in the back, raise your hand, I'll try to speak to Alex, if you can hear me.
But if I cast out devils by the Spirit of Yahweh, then the kingdom of Yahweh is come unto you.
That's 27:28.
12:28.
Right, 38.
Well, 38 of Matthew. Then certain of the scribes and of the Pharisees answered, saying, Master, we would see a sign from thee.
They asked him to see a sign of him. That's what he asked for, a sign. Now, all the things he's been doing up to this time, he's been giving them signs all along who he was. Yeah. But they asked specifically for a sign. We want to see a sign from thee, read.
And he answered and said unto them.
He answered and said unto them.
An evil and adulterous generation.
Now, what kind of people were he dealing with?
Evil.
He's talking about the evil and adulterous generation. So he's talking about the people at that time, were the evil and adulterous generation. We mean the same thing now, so that goes. Mm-hmm. Hasn't changed. Okay, read on.
Seeketh after a sign.
Seeketh after a sign.
And there shall no sign be given to it.
Then he said there be no sign given. Read.
But the sign of the prophet Jonah.
But the sign of the prophet Jonah. So that would mean if you wanted to know the sign, you have to go back and read Jonah to find out the sign is referring to the Messiah. Read on.
For as Jonah was 3 days and three nights.
For as Jonah 3 days and three nights.
In the fish belly.
In the fish belly.
So shall the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth.
So he's making a comparison. Jonah in the belly of the fish for 3 days, three nights, and the Son of Man will be in the heart of the earth 3 days, three nights. Now, your ministers don't go into this. Don't try to figure it out or try to show it to their student body about, or their in the church or the congregation about how that was done. And you can see very easily about the problem that they would have about that when you consider. Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. We're doing that Wednesday day. Thursday night would be the Passover. Mm-hmm. I took the Messiah to the priest that morning, which was Friday morning, and that's when he went out to crucify Friday morning, and he was on the cross at 9 o'clock in the morning. Then, so that's Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. So that's 1, 2, 3, and 2 nights. You have 3 days, three nights there. So they got a problem with that. And the religion has a problem with that all the time, see? So we got to understand some things. To make it clear for everybody to understand, because I got some young students in the class here too, and some probably haven't even heard us talk about this that much.
Right.
It's something that we need to talk about. Often too, from time to time, just so people be abreast of it. But we're showing you how the Messiah, what he did, how he did it. How did he fulfill the 3 days, three nights? Mm-hmm. What was the death, burial, and resurrection all about? What other things pointed to his death, burial, and resurrection? There's a whole lot of things to go into. Now, I might not get to them all today, but anyhow, we're going to try to cover some of them anyhow. So I'm going to ask you all to bear with me, and we'll try to get to that. So now, we see the problem here. We got 3 days, two nights. Problem we have. Now, I haven't yet found a good way to illustrate this like I'd like to, but the point I want you to see is this. When they crucified, 9 o'clock in the morning, daylight. Before I go there, I gotta get this here. Genesis 1 and 3. Then give me 1 Timothy 3:16.
Genesis 1 and 3.
Mm-hmm.
And Elohim said,
Elohim said,
let there be light.
Let there be light. Now, this is, now I want you to understand, this is, oh, there's so many things that I know we got some people younger than me. I have never understood this at well yet. But we're talking about Elohim. That's when Moses is up on the mount, hearing Elohim speak, bringing his creation in. So what I'm saying to you here is that Elohim says, so Moses heard Elohim say something. Read.
Let there be light.
So let there be light.
And there was light.
And there was light.
And read. Elohim saw the light. He saw the light.
He saw the light.
That it was good.
That it was good.
And Elohim divided the light from the darkness.
He made a division between light and darkness.
And Elohim called the light day.
Elohim called, now would you understand? Mm-hmm. Elohim, right. He called the light day.
And the darkness he called night.
And the darkness he called night.
And the evening and the morning were the first day.
The evening and the morning was the first day. Mm-hmm. Now to you be that we are nighttime.
Yes.
But Yahweh showing this to Moses in a vision atop Mount Sinai. So that cloud covering the mount, he's in the cloud, or in the middle of eternity. So now he's saying to him, and then we're hearing Yahweh saying to him, he's the one to identify light as being day, darkness as being night.
Right.
Okay? Mm-hmm. Now that's Elohim, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now, I think I asked for a second, 1 Timothy 3:16.
1 Timothy 3:16. Mm-hmm. And without controversy.
Now, Paul is writing here. Says, without controversy. There's no argument about this now. No debate about it.
Great is the mystery of holiness.
And he said, great is the mystery of holiness. Read.
Yahweh was manifest in the flesh.
Wait. We got to get this in. He said, Yahweh was manifested in the flesh. See? Read.
Justified in the spirit. Seen of angels. Preached unto the Gentiles. Believed on in the world. Received up into glory.
And received up into glory. Now this Yahweh, see, he said it was manifested in the flesh. I want to verify that. Give me John 1:1-3, and then down to the 14th verse. I'm trying to, I want you to see what we're talking about. See, mankind, they try to look at, try to examine this thing, and look at this thing, try to determine these 3 days, 3 nights, and they come and say, you got to be 72 hours, you got to be in the grave.
Right.
Not so. Mm-hmm. We got to say, it's so many things, folks. But I want you to, I hope you'll be able to follow along with what I'm trying to show you. That Yahweh, well, let's read this anyway. I'll say it that way.
John 1:1.
Uh-huh.
In the beginning.
So here's John. He says, in the beginning.
Was the Word.
Was the Word. In the beginning of what? And when? A lot of things we read over it. We don't talk about it in the church. We don't talk about it. Mm-hmm. In the beginning of his creation. See? Which means Yahweh, pure spirit, took on shape and form as Yahweh Elohim. That's the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
And when he took on shape and form, that's the Word.
Mm-hmm.
Now, see, when you're reading your Bible, think about this when you're reading the Bible. When it says Yahweh said, that's not so.
Right.
It's Elohim that said.
Mm-hmm.
Yahweh that said, Yahweh had to take on shape and form and have a mouth talk, speak to him. And because, by understanding that, you'll see that Yahweh took on this shape and form. Mm-hmm. Now, John is writing, in the beginning was the Word. Or Yahweh Elohim in shape and form.
Mm-hmm.
See? And Yahweh Elohim talking to Moses back there, said, let there be light. Read on.
In the beginning was the Word.
Mm-hmm.
And the Word was with Yahweh.
And the Word was with Yahweh.
And the Word was Yahweh.
And the Word was Yahweh. Now we got to understand that now. That means that Yahweh, he's pure spirit. What do you mean by that? I'm talking about the divine attributes that make him what? Intelligent wisdom, not intelligent. Knowledge, wisdom, and understanding. Oh, wow.
Wisdom and knowledge.
Wisdom and knowledge, love, beauty, justice, power, foundation, and strength. Those attributes make up spirit. They are, all of them are invisible to the naked eye. That's what makes him up. But now, when he was making himself known to man, he had to take on a shape and form to appear to him in vision and revelation. So that's what he did. So he took on a shape and form. That became the Word. So that's a speaking on behalf of Yahweh. Okay, read.
The same was in the beginning with Yahweh.
The same was in the beginning with Yahweh.
All things were made by him.
Now he said, now all things were made by him. Right. So we understand, all things were made by him. That's not all things. Read.
And without him was not anything made that was made.
And without him was not anything made that was made.
14 verse.
Now, that's we're talking about Yahweh taking on that shape and form. See? That's the Word. Okay? Now, go down to the 14th verse.
And the Word was made flesh.
Now, he says, now the Word was made flesh.
And dwelt among us.
So that means that the Spirit of Yahweh now is incarnated in a physical body. See? So when we talk about Yahshua Shai, we're talking about Yahweh in a physical body. Mm-hmm. So now, when we talk about the Messiah being crucified, now we got to deal with time with him, not time with mankind.
Right.
That's true.
That's the distinction we got to make.
Right.
See? Time with Yahweh, the time with man. There be all kinds of things you got to keep in mind when we talk about this stuff. So in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with Yahweh, and the Word was Yahweh. And the Word was made flesh, and it beheld his glory. So now when he was in that physical body now, he's not looking at time, looking at day and night, as you and I look at day and night. See? So when he's on the cross, at 9 o'clock in the daylight, then your book reads out, I think we read the scripture, that 9 o'clock it turned
dark.
At the 6 hour it turned dark, pardon. 6 hour. At 6 hour, which would be 12 o'clock. It turned dark. And it would darken to the 9th hour, which would be 3 o'clock. So you got a space of light and darkness with him. That's a day with him. Then you got from 3 o'clock in the afternoon to regular nighttime. That would be daylight again. And then you got the regular night. So what we're saying to you, what we're trying to declare to you, is that with Yahweh, you got 2 days. In that one day. You got you. Anybody know what I'm saying about that now? I want to make sure everybody understands, because I'm trying to declare these 3 days and 3 nights. So on that first day, that Friday, you got 2 days and 2 nights. Now that night, that Friday night, see, going into the Saturday morning, see, that's night. You got day, Saturday night. Raised up very early Sunday morning. It would be the first day of the week. Yes.
So you're saying you got 2 light periods and 2 dark periods.
Yes.
And the light he called day and the darkness he called night.
Right. That's what I'm trying to say. It was Yahweh Elohim who said that. And I'm saying Yahweh Elohim is in Yahshua Shai. So with him, he's looking at days and nights with him. So we're trying to get it. We go about 9 o'clock and we say, well, that Friday, that's 24 hours.
Yeah.
You got Saturday, that's 24 hours. You got Sunday, 24 hours. See? So they try to figure it out. So they go all the way back and move all the way even to Wednesday. You're on Wednesday. So I think there's so many things out there now. We're trying to correct them. We just have a hard time trying to do that. But I'm trying to show you what.
Did you maybe have read Zechariah 14, 6, and 7?
Not yet. I'm coming to it. Coming to that. Thank you. Now. So I'm trying to show you with him.
Right.
Yahweh was in Yahshua. And if we're breaking time with him. Okay? So that being so, then you have to see that You got scriptures that testify when that had to happen. In other words, this event, this is all of a sudden come upon the scene, right. But it had to happen. See? So give me, give me one more. Amos 8 and 9, mm-hmm. And then we'll give me Zechariah 14 and 6.
Amos 8 and 9.
Now, I want you to pay attention to what's being said here. So we see how this all ties together. See, these are things that Fowler taught to us over the years. And trying to explain to somebody, to get somebody to understand it, can be hard. But I'm trying to take my time until everybody can understand what's being said here. So you have this Yahweh now. Here is spirit. Took on a ship and form. Yahweh. Now he's the one that dictated to Moses about how he created the creation. So we've got time with him now. We've got always so many things. But let's take one thing at a time.
Yeah.
Let's get one thing at a time. Yeah. Read that.
And it shall come to pass.
It shall come to pass.
In that day.
In that day. So sometime in this is a prophecy now. So it means it's being said, spoke about way ahead of time. See? Amos 2, Amos 8 and 9, read.
And it shall come to pass.
It shall come to pass.
In that day.
In that day. So someday it's going to happen. See? That day what?
Saith Yahweh Elohim.
Saith Yahweh Elohim.
That I will cause the sun to go down at noon.
I will cause the sun to go down at noon.
And I will darken the earth in a clear day.
And I will darken the earth in a clear day. Now, I haven't had too many experiences here. Back in Ohio, that place right there, you find the storm coming, it gets real, real dark, almost all day night. See? I mean, it might be 12, might be 10 o'clock in the morning. Turn really dark. But then you know a storm is coming. And it'll come, you got thunder and light, everything, the whole thing comes to pass. But now, he's talking about that if they know, well, read that. I'll give you Zechariah.
Zechariah 14 and 6.
Uh-huh.
And it shall come to pass.
And it shall come to pass.
In that day.
In that day.
That the light shall not be clear.
And the night shall not be clear.
Nor dark.
Nor dark.
But it shall be one day.
It shall be one day.
Which shall be known to Yahweh.
Which shall be known to Yahweh. Remember, we're talking about Yahweh in that body of Yahshua.
Right.
So it's going to be a day known to him. Read.
Not day. Nor night.
Nor night.
But it shall come to pass.
But it shall come to pass.
That at evening time.
At evening time.
It shall be light.
It shall be light. So at 3 o'clock, we turn light again. So you have light, darkness. See, light, as we say, from 6 a.m. to 9. That's when you're crucified. See, and then it turned dark at the 6 hour, which would be 12. So you got light from 6 to 12, and then you got darkness from 12 to 3. Now that's one day.
Right.
Then from 3 in the afternoon, the light came again, because the clouds moved out of the way. And you got light again. Till 6 o'clock at night, that evening. Then you got back in dark. So you got 2 days and 2 nights.
In
that Friday. See? Then Saturday, we're going to take care of itself. See, you got the Friday is the end of Friday, that Friday night. And Saturday, you got Saturday day, then go into Saturday night.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you already got 2 days, then you got another day, which would be Saturday, that'd be third day.
Right.
So you got to raise this third day. You got to raise.
Mm-hmm.
Now, we've got somewhat covered that. Probably not in details as we want to get into it. But now he said that. Mm-hmm. Now what are the scriptures that tie into that? In his death, burial, and resurrection?
John
2
and 19.
Huh?
John 2 and 19.
Yeah.
Now, everybody say, okay.
Mm-hmm.
See, you did, what was it there?
John 2:19.
They told the story.
John 2.
2:19.
2:19.
Okay.
Destroy this temple.
Yeah, okay. That's a good one. You have Daniel?
Yeah, 300 days.
Okay, Daniel 8:44 in the Holy Name, 8:6, 14 in the Holy Name. So now, let's see if we get this together. Everybody on the same page. What's that?
You got the phenomenal day with Israel. You don't want that one?
We're trying to establish that you see that what the Messiah was doing, he was fulfilling what he was going to say about him.
Right.
That's what I'm trying to get across. That makes you be aware that he was the right one. Mm-hmm. Nobody else is going to meet this requirement. See? Are you planning to go get on a cross at 9 and darkness will come and you're going to die and back to the clock and ready? Are you going to do all that? If you're not, then we know it's not you. See, or anybody go in the past, get that beside him. See? So I'm trying to identify that he's the right one. See? Now. I know I shouldn't ask the question. It's all good. We ain't got too far out of Genesis yet. See? But I'm saying you see the scriptures do testify of God Himself. That's what I'm trying to emphasize. See? And when you see things that deal with the Messiah's death, burial, and resurrection. See? And a lot of times we don't think about some of the other things that go along with that. So now, I want to do this now. That's the main. Okay, we have one scripture called Daniel. There were two scriptures out of Daniel. 9. Uh, 24. There was Daniel. King James 8:14. Holy Name 6:14. Now I'm reading the scripture so you see now. The Bible is foretelling what the Messiah is going to do. So when you come down to the Messiah, you know that you had the right one. You have nobody else to meet these requirements, these specifications. That's what makes this teaching so profound, because we are doing what the scriptures say. He says, search the scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life. So you got to go into the scriptures and see how the scriptures testify of the Messiah. See? Okay. That's reading, so everybody have on Dr. What Pope said. I had Daniel 9:24.
Daniel 9:24. 70 weeks are determined upon thy people.
Now he's saying, he's giving a prophecy now. The 70 weeks are determined upon that people. Read.
And upon thy holy city.
And upon thy holy city. This is a prophecy now. This is about 567 years before the Messiah comes in the world. Okay, we are.
To finish the transgression.
And now his mission is, he's on a mission. Remember, he's coming to do the will of the Father. He's on a mission to do something for the Father. To finish the transgression.
And to make an end of sins.
He's going to make an end of sin. He's not going to come in and establish it. He's going to come in and make an end of sin. Read.
And to make reconciliation for iniquity.
And make reconciliation for iniquity.
And to bring in everlasting righteousness.
And he'll bring in everlasting righteousness. This is all he's going to accomplish. This is all going to be done within the 7 weeks. Actually, being done in the last 30 years of that time. He's like, okay, bring on.
And to seal up the vision and prophecy. And to anoint the Most Holy.
So So it's all that's going to be done within this 400, within the 70 weeks or 490 years. Okay, somebody don't know what we're saying about that, I must illustrate that to you. Times 7 days in a week. 490 days. And then we go back and get property time, 1 day for a year. So 490 years. So whenever the command is given, then 490 years from that, he's got to be on scene, he's got to fulfill all this by the end of that time. That's what we're saying, what we're talking about. So when the Messiah comes in, he's coming in on time to fulfill the will of the Father. Have we lost anybody so far? Okay. Anybody think again? So now what I'm saying to you now, that's a prophecy and what had to be done within the 490 years. It has a starting point. His servant. I'll see Mark, I see it. Don't worry about it. Okay, down here, done. Okay, now, what I'm saying to you is this, that this Yahweh has prophesied to the prophets what was going to transpire. So now what we're doing, we're now trying to see how they come, how they came to pass, and see how it applied to the Messiah, that you and I might believe that he's the right one.
Right, okay.
Okay, now. Let's go with the other one in Daniel 8:14, King James, and 6:14, Holy Name.
Daniel 8:14, King James. And he said unto me, then I heard one son speaking. And another son said, unto that certain son, which spake, how long shall be the vision?
Remember some of the vision that Daniel. How long should that vision be? Read. Concerning the daily sacrifice in the tabernacle. Read.
And the transgression of desolation. To give both the sanctuary and the host to be trodden underfoot.
Read.
And he said unto me, unto 2,300 days, then shall the sanctuary be cleansed.
Now everybody got a hold of anybody, don't be upset now, but it says 2,200 days. we're going to do something else and we're all going wrong. I'm going to take time to go here right now. But the point is, it was 2,300 days. Has to be a way to verify that, to confirm that too. So the point I'm trying to get across to you now, we got a prophecy now. Proper time is 1 day for a year. So it's 2,300 2,300 days. Okay. Now, we gotta get it. Hope I say it clear enough for everybody to follow. Now, Psalms 94, 1 Peter 3 and 8.
Psalms 90 and 4. For 1,000 years in thy sight are yet as yesterday when it is past, and as the watch in the night.
Second Peter 3:8. Second Peter 3:8.
Now, that was Psalm.
That was Psalm.
Now we're going to get it through here with David's, Paul's confirming.
Peter, Second Peter 3:8. But beloved, be not ignorant of this one thing.
Beloved, be not ignorant of this one thing.
That one day with Yahweh as 1,000 years and
one
1,000.
One day with Yahweh. Now this is the time, but let me say it. This is one day with Yahweh. Now when you meet with Yahweh. It is 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is as one day. Mm-hmm. Okay.
And 1,000 years is one day.
So having 1,000 years equals one day. Mm-hmm. So we read over in Daniel, 2,300 days. Yeah. So for the Messiah coming on, he's now we're dealing with time with him now. He's talking about the sanctuary being cleansed. He's not talking about the temple that was built there too. He's not talking about the tabernacle. He's talking about his body. He's the sanctuary. So this Messiah's death, burial, and resurrection is going to cover a lot of things. You're going to see a lot of things that are going to come back to be done by him. So now, here's something I already got here on here. Friday 1,000, Saturday 1,000. Three other parts of the third day. He's doing all that. He's coming. Y'all going to be on that now? 1,000 Friday, 1,000 Saturday, and 300 parts of Sunday. As we call it. And they hope in the Bible will be the first day of the week. Okay, now. So when the Messiah was crucified, see the man in front of it? I can't see it. Y'all can't see through me, so I know that. He's not here. So now, we're talking about the Messiah being crucified, Friday 1,000. Mm-hmm. You got Saturday 2,000, and Sunday 300 apart. Now, Dr. Kennedy tried hard to put everything on the chart to be able to see things and understand what's going on. So now, when the Messiah was crucified on Friday, they took his body out and put it in Joseph's tomb over the Sabbath day. Why are you doing that for? I've got to remove the Sabbath out of the way. So I got to see it in the tombs over Sabbath day. So I moved the Sabbath out. And then the 300 part of Sunday morning, 3 days from the dead. Now, what's going on with that? Stealing your way. So now we have the Messiah coming in. And you remember he's fulfilling now. So now we have got to go back now and get Adam. You find Adam after he touched the tree. He died in his conscience right away. Mm-hmm. 300, he lived 930 years and he died. Okay? So what we're saying to you is that you've got... ...130 years and 1,000. You're 7 years short of that day. So when the Messiah comes in, since Adam fell, he's 7 years short. So when the Messiah comes in, he's got to complete that day. So when he raises from the dead, the 300 part of that day, 700 parts is left to be fulfilled. That's what he did when he raised from the dead. So when he raised from the dead, what happens when he raised from the dead?
Sunrise. You all got it. That's good.
See, it's a matter of how you put all this stuff together.
The prophecy of Daniel being fulfilled.
Huh?
You just read Daniel, and it's fulfilled, but it ends that transgression.
Yes, but that's exactly right. That's why the 7 weeks has got to be fulfilled. That's what we got in Daniel. So he's got to accomplish all that, the end of sin, all that's going to be done by his resurrection. By his resurrection. Mm-hmm. Okay? So we're talking about the other thing we got going on. You go by earthquake. Mm-hmm. Can you all read this over one more time there in Matthew? In 27, I think it's 27. They're about 50.
Matthew 27 and 50. Joshua, when he had cried again with a loud voice, yielded up the spirit.
Now you say he yielded up the spirit.
Or the ghost.
Or the ghost. Reading.
And behold, the veil of the temple was rent in twain. From the top to the bottom.
From the top to the bottom.
And the earth did quake.
And the earth did quake.
And the rocks rent.
Oh, right there. The rocks rent. Okay, we'll be on.
And the graves were opened.
Not yet.
No.
This is death now. Mm-hmm. Raise and rent until you raise from the dead.
Redeemed later.
See, I tell you, the Bible, they put it together, the situation is kind of hard to keep things together. Because now what we're trying to convey to you is that the earthquake when he was crucified, that's what we're talking about that Friday, the veil in the temple was rent in twain. The veil that divided between the most holy place and the holy place, that was rent in twain. That veil represented the flesh. You're talking about his flesh.
Oh, yeah.
You got questions over this past week about him coming in? So now we're dealing with him. Earthquake and the veil of the temple is running twain. Then when you read on, as you were reading on that's where you read. Come and read it again, please.
And the earth did quake, and the rocks rent, mm-hmm. and the graves were opened.
Not yet. But read it.
And the graves were open, and many of the bodies of the sons which slept arose and came out of the graves after his resurrection.
You see, they got all that wrapped up in that one verse here.
They do.
See?
No. Yeah.
You gotta break that down some. See? When he died, it was earthquake.
On Friday.
On Friday. I think it's in the 28th chapter, we read about another earthquake. You got two earthquakes. Mm-hmm. On the Friday and on the Sunday morning. Because I remember the women went out to the washway buried the side, they washed away buried him at. And they seen him roll a stone up to the tomb, and they were talking about who's gonna roll a stone away for us. Because they going out there to know his body. But they had an earthquake and Yahweh rolled a stone away. This is making sense tonight. Is in the last word, the 27th chapter, where somebody, an angel came down and wrote a stone away, or is it the next chapter? 28.
And behold, there was a great earthquake.
Okay.
For the angel of Yahweh descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and set upon it.
Set upon it. Now, see, you gotta show him sitting on the stone back here. He'll see on the chart. He'll see. See? He rolled away his stone and he ain't rolled away his stone. See? Let me get John looking at that. Revelation 21.
Revelation 20:1. Mm-hmm. And I saw an angel come down from heaven.
Now he said he saw an angel. This is John out there. He's looking back at this event back here. He said he saw an angel come down from heaven.
Having the key of the bottomless pit.
Having the key to the bottomless pit. What was the bottomless pit? Death. Grave. Mm-hmm. He's got the keys to the bottom, so he's going to unlock the grave or unlock death. Breathe.
And a great chain in his hand.
A great chain in his hand. He's linking these agents together. He's linking them together. Mm-hmm. Great chain in his hand. So he's coming out of the post-illuminate age, coming to the present age. Mm-hmm. So he's linking them together. Okay? This angel come down. Read.
And he laid hold on the dragon.
Laid hold on the dragon. And the dragon would be Satan or the devil. Laid hold on the reed.
That old serpent.
That
which
old
is
serpent.
The devil.
The devil.
And Satan.
And Satan.
And bound him 1,000 years.
And bound him 1,000 years. Hold him with that. I'm way, way, way ahead of where I want to be at. $1,000, $2,000, so he raised him from the dead. How does that read there in that 20th verse, the first verse, how does that read?
Matthew 28:1. In the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week.
As it began to dawn to the first day of the week, so not even daylight yet. It's going out early in the morning. Okay.
Came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to the sepulchre.
Okay, now. Get John 20:1. If somebody wants to go Mark 16:1.
Matthew 20:1.
Mm-hmm.
Or John 20:1. The first day of the week cometh Mary Magdalene.
First day of the week comes Mary Magdalene.
Early. The first day of the week cometh Mary Magdalene early. When it was yet dark.
When it was yet dark, so it hadn't turned light yet. Now, remember, now, we deal with see these things. How would you mark the time when the high priest went into the most holy place, going through that veil?
Candlestick.
I'm trying to get you to see the split second that it takes. You can't tell us that. When does the sun rise and when does the sun set? Can you draw a line demarcation current up?
No.
When you consider the sun, when you and I say you see it rise, the sun, light from the sun, has left it. The sun, 8 minutes ago. So I mean, the sun's been traveling for 8 minutes before you even see the little glimmer of light. So you don't see the sun rise. You're going to see him rise. Mm-hmm. But he rose very early in the morning. Mm-hmm. Okay, now that's what I'm trying to point. If you want to take time and read the other accounts, you can just read the accounts, you see all these accounts that you have. I mean, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and John talking about the Messiah's resurrection. And you see early in the morning, as it began to dawn, all this is kind of terminology they use about the time the women went out to the sepulchre.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you all I'm saying now, I'm talking about this timing now. So here's the Messiah now. He raised from the dead. We read that in Revelation that he raised from the dead. Satan came down and bound Satan for 1,000 years. Had a great change in him. He was bringing an end of that old covenant and bringing in the new covenant. So now what I'm saying is that when he was raised from the dead, and John is reading there, that stone was rolled away, he's coming beside. That body that was put in the tomb, vanishes or disappears. Mm-hmm. The body is going back to the spirit.
The soul.
Huh?
The soul? I mean, the spirit? You said body. So
I said body.
The flesh.
The flesh. The flesh is gone. I'm trying to say, okay. When you raise with it, when you wear it too, you find the body nowhere around. So the flesh is consumed. The soul, see, moving on. Back up there, you had the 27th chapter of Matthew, and he said he yielded the ghost or the spirit. Mm-hmm. Or he said ghost or spirit. Mm-hmm. Okay. Yielded the ghost. So that him, that did not get in the tomb. That spirit did not get in the tomb. That spirit went and preached to the captives in the strait. Those that had died, from Adam all the way down, he went and preached to them. He's preaching to them. And when he raised from the dead, they come up after his resurrection. Mm-hmm. And you got the spirit there. So I'm trying to cover all these grounds here. So when he raised from the dead, the man's sons and stepped, they rose after his resurrection. But when he really didn't find nobody. I said, when the women went, they didn't find nobody. So the angel, he's going to go before you going into Galilee. So you'll find the Messiah going, he appeared to you on the way to Galilee. So now, what I'm trying to convey to you is that he raised from the dead. I might suppose him right now. First Corinthians 15. I think about 45. I think of one. The one we're talking about the summer natural age of spiritual. Mm-hmm. I think 45. What you put in there?
First Corinthians 15:44. It is sown a natural body.
But he was sown a natural body, by taking off the cross and putting the tomb. Read.
It is raised a spiritual body.
And he's raised a spiritual body.
There is a natural body.
There is a natural body.
And there is a spiritual body.
There is a spiritual body. So we got a natural body now, and we are anticipating receiving a spiritual body at the revelation of God's Messiah. Okay. Now, Mark 16:12.
Mark 16:12. After that he appeared in another form unto the two of them.
Now he's talking about the two men who wanted to meet. He appeared to them in another form. Sure, it's not the physical body, not the spiritual body. Another form. The scripture says it's another form. It says he raised a physical body. Right. He did not raise a physical body. He raised a spirit according to the spirit. And that's what we're trying to get you to see, that there's a spiritual body. That then gives you hope. See, because when we talk, Yahweh is saving your soul, not your body. The spirit of Yahweh, the spirit is in you, that's of Yahweh. He's saving your soul. So souls will be saved and souls will be lost. One's believing, one's not believing. Basically, that's the whole thing. Now, you brought me. Somebody give another scripture. Robert, you may go. Somebody give another scripture. I wish I'd got more.
What's your Mark 16 and 14? Mark 16:12,
but you're going to ask for Mark 16:14. I need that. Tell them the charge to go back, go and preach the gospel, because that's what he's talking about. Now, Mark 16:12. Matthew 3:5-6, and then go down to 13 and 14.
Matthew 3:5-6. Then went out to him Jerusalem and
all. Now this is John the Baptist now.
Right.
So then went out to him John the Baptist. Read.
Then went out to him Jerusalem and all of Judea and all the region round about Jordan, and were baptized of him in Jordan, confessing their sins.
And when you see here, confess their sins. Why? If we do, I want you to understand you're talking to the Jews and the Jews only.
Right.
There were only Jews back here in Egypt, so you can't be nothing but Jews down here when the Messiah was baptized to. They confess their sins. So, when they confess a sin, they are showing that they were dead. Mm-hmm. Being buried in the water was showing them being buried. Mm-hmm. So you think about it, baptism doesn't have to do with it besides death, burial, and resurrection. But yes. Mm-hmm. You have to be buried in God's Messiah. Mm-hmm. What's next?
13. Mm-hmm. Then cometh Joshua from Galilee to Jordan unto John to be baptized of him.
Mm-hmm.
But John forbade him, saying,
But John forbade him, saying,
I have need to be baptized of thee.
I need to be baptized of thee.
And comest thou to me?
So John asked him, had he sinned? He said, No, I haven't sinned. He said, Well, I need to be baptized of thee. Why comest thou for me? Mm-hmm. If you haven't sinned, why are you coming to me? I'm only baptized of sinner. But Messiah had the conviction to baptize, because if he didn't baptize, he would not see the sign of being identified who he was. Mm-hmm. So it had to be done. So then John baptized. Never you got there, read it before them.
And Joshua answered and said unto him, suffered it to be so now, for thus it becometh us to fulfill all righteousness.
Fulfill all righteousness.
Then he suffered him.
Okay, well, that means fulfilling what else?
And Yahshua, and
Where does Yahshua fulfill him? By being baptized.
The earth and then they get in water.
Okay, now we get what I want now. So I'm trying to show how encompassed this whole thing is about. You deal with Noah, and when Moses never come out of the come up, Israel coming out of Egypt through the Red Sea. Mm-hmm. That was baptism too. Mm-hmm. See? Going back and you got Adam, you got the earth inundated with water, Genesis. Mm-hmm. Well, let's get Genesis 3:9.
Noah.
Huh?
Noah.
All this came. You see, the death, burial, and resurrection encompasses the whole Bible. And you got to see that these things testify, and that's why it's so important for you and I to see that the scriptures do testify to Joshua's eyes. Now, okay, give me Genesis. Genesis 1-3, 1-9. Well, I need to push. The earth was inundated with water. So that means the earth was buried. Then you read in the ninth verse, but Yahweh said, let the waters roll off the face of the dry land. That's a resurrection of the earth on the third day.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Poor Daniel, this has to be done on the third day.
Right.
See, that's what I'm trying to see. And going back. Y'all be talking about it already. When Yahweh took on shape and form.
Oh, okay.
That's in the bosom of the Father.
Right.
You baptize in the bosom of the Father.
That's true.
I'm talking about this, he was buried in the bosom of the Father, say that way. Because he was in that spiritual realm. See? So you see, he's got to come all the way down. He's got to pick up all his baptism. That's what he's doing by him being baptized. He brought all that to an end. See, now, see, Romans 6:3. I hope I'm trying to get this card. I'm trying to show you that the scriptures are testifying this, and that this baptism involves all these things. We ain't even been ready to go with the Passover or nothing like that yet. That's all. That's before they got baptized, but that's all right. Okay. I want a little bit about the
Romans 6:3. Knowing not that so many of us.
Now this is Paul writing. Knowing not that so many of us. Us who?
Jews.
No, in the church is saying so many of us. Talking about the church world, the church.
Mm-hmm.
No, talking about the Jews.
As we're baptized unto Yahshua the Messiah.
As we're baptized unto Yahshua the Messiah. So that means we're baptized before he died. We're baptized before he died. Read.
We're baptized unto his death.
We're baptized into his death. Read.
Therefore, we are buried with him.
We are buried with him.
By baptism into death.
By baptism. You're talking about the Jews, baptized with him into death. Read.
Like as a Messiah was raised up from the dead.
Oh! See, a baptism, now I'm talking about a resurrection. Now, as the Messiah was raised from the dead.
By the glory of the Father.
By the glory of the Father.
Even so we also. Jews. Should walk in newness of life.
Should walk in newness of life. That means now, back in the old covenant, we deal with things in the old covenant. But now you got to be dealing with the new things. You don't deal with the natural things anymore. We don't.
For if we have been planted together in the likeness of death.
For we Jews have been planted together with him.
Unto his death.
Into his death.
We shall be also in the likeness of his resurrection.
Then we shall also be in the likeness of his resurrection. Mm-hmm. See, I didn't the resurrection, he's talking about death. By being baptized.
Knowing this. That our old man is crucified with him. That the body of sin.
That the body of sin.
Might be destroyed.
That
henceforth, we should not serve sin. For he that is dead is free from sin.
He that is dead is free from sin. See, a dead man can't sin.
Now, if we be dead with the Messiah.
Now, if we be dead with the Messiah.
We believe.
As a condition, if. If we be dead with the Messiah.
We believe that we shall also live with him.
Then we shall also live with him. Read.
Knowing that the Messiah, being raised from the dead.
Now, knowing that the Messiah being raised from the dead.
He dieth no more.
He dieth no more.
Death hath no more dominion over him.
Death hath no more dominion over him. Read.
For in that he died.
For in that he died.
He died unto sin once.
He died unto sin once. Just like Adam, he died in disobedience once. And that got everybody. Messiah's going, he had to get everybody. Now read.
But in that he liveth.
For in that he liveth.
He liveth unto Yahweh.
He liveth unto Yahweh. Read.
Likewise.
Now it says likewise. Now we're talking about somebody else now. We're talking about the Gentile. Likewise, the Gentile.
Likewise,
you go and do the same thing they did. No, we don't.
Likewise, reckon.
Now he says, reckon. You say, go do it. He says, reckon. They say, you got to do psychology in your mind. You got to believe that he died. You got to do that psychology in your mind. And when you believe it, that's what will set you free from the law of the carnal ordinance and all this stuff. We don't.
Likewise, reckon ye also yourselves to be dead. Indeed, under sin.
Under sin.
But alive unto Yahweh through Yahshua the Messiah.
But alive unto Yahweh through Yahshua Messiah. So we can't get around. We've got to go through Yahshua Messiah. That's why he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. We got to go through that. See? So when you embrace Yahshua Messiah, Paul writes again there, Colossians 2 and 9, you are completed in him. So once you accept Yahshua Messiah, you got everything he did, you are completed in him. He was baptized, he was circumcised, he was to pass over all that stuff. So when you accept him, you got all that done. You don't have to do that no more now. Because now you can breathe in Yahshua Messiah by faith in him. So now when the Messiah raised from the dead, that veil in the temple was rent in twain. The veil in the temple was represented the flesh. So the flesh has gone out. That's why Paul writes there in 2 Corinthians 5 and I think 16 and 17, he said, we don't know man after the flesh. Because the Messiah, we know him after the flesh, but we don't know him no more after the flesh now. So it's not after the flesh now. So we got to lift our eyes above the flesh now. What it is we got to see what's speaking through that body. See, that's where Dr. Sheff in his prayer talking about discerning the spirit. That's what you have to do now. Discern whether they tell you the truth or not tell you the truth. And as you do that, you're going to be able to see then that somebody has been lying to you. And come down here, somebody holy telling you the truth. So now you're seeing that now. See? Now, okay, now,
Can we do that
2 Corinthians
16?
5:16. 5:16,
sorry.
Yeah, 5:16, okay, let me read that. Look, folks, look. Since you're there in 1 Corinthians 5, go up to the 10th verse, please.
1 Corinthians 5 and 10. For we must all appear before the judgment seat.
Now, I'm not sure how important this is. I say everybody in here, everybody. We're all going to appear before the judgment seat of God's Messiah. We're all going to appear. Read.
That everyone may receive the things done in his body.
Everyone is going to receive the things done in his body.
According to that he hath done.
Now, I may not know what you've done, but Yahshua does, or Yahweh does. Well, Yahweh's in you. He's telling you what's going on. So he's gonna be the one judging. I can have this list so you can see how important it is for you as an individual that he's going to judge you everywhere. Every man in the religion is going to be judged. And you're not going to be up there from standing in line, coming out, and he's got a big book up there. You take it off of this, it's not going to be like that, though. Think about it. Let's just say Albuquerque and Lyon. Each one of them, you'd be here all day and probably after tomorrow doing that. It's not going to be that way. See? Your record is within you right then. So when you die, whatever way you die, either you know him or don't know him, that's where you're going to stand before Yahweh, and Yahweh is going to judge you based upon that. Your name is written in the book of life. And he knows you by name. When Messiah came along and says, hey, you fishing over there, come follow me. You call him by name. So you call him by name, so you can see the name, you can know him by name, so you know he knows you, me by name. If you don't know, you should know by now, because we read about it. See, so now that I'm saying to you that you can see the Messiah, he is the right one now. See? Now, so when the Messiah raised from the dead on the third, that 300 part of that day. Now, in the book where the Satan was bound 1,000 years. So from the time that 300 part of that day, the rest of the day would be 700 part of that day. Would be that Satan was bound. You read there in the 28th chapter when the stories came up to the San Diego Council. So hey, he raised like he said he would. He raised like he said he would. Why? No, we can't have that get out. This is money for you. Look, see that. The Sabbath came and stole him away. See? Have you ever seen anybody who steal a son away? See, that means that didn't happen. So the point is, you see that now you read over there. You're supposed to read, okay, we'll read down for it, right? I saw that he's going to call every man is going to stand before Yahweh. And Yahweh is going to judge you based on what you've done at home in his body. Read on.
Whether it be good or bad. Knowing therefore the terror of Yahweh. We persuade men, but we are made manifest. Unto Yahweh. And I trust also are made manifest in your conscience.
Hope you understand it and you transform your conscience. Read.
For we commend not ourselves again unto you,
right,
but give you occasion to glory on our behalf, that ye may have somewhat to answer them which glory in appearance and not in heart.
Now you go shut down.
16. Wherefore henceforth know ye no man after the flesh.
I said, now know ye no man after the flesh. Read.
Yea, though we know the Messiah after the flesh.
Even though the disciples, they knew the Messiah after the flesh.
Yet now henceforth know he him no more.
Now we don't know him no more.
Wherefore, if any man be in the Messiah.
Now, if any man be in the Messiah.
He is a new creature.
He's a new creature. You don't think that he is today.
Old things are passed away.
The whole covenant, all the things you had to do in the church, what you do is passed away. Turn away with me.
Behold, all things are become new.
All things have become new.
And all things are of Yahweh.
All things are of Yahweh.
Who hath reconciled us to himself by Yahshua the Messiah.
Now he's reconciled us unto himself by Yahweh. That's how come we're coming down here and we're hoping, as we are preaching the gospel, you are here and you are becoming one with Yahshua by faith in him. That's how we all will be one. See? So now, as you and I come and learn of him, you're becoming one-minded or one with him, knowing why he did the things he did, what he said and did. Knowing that, that's what's setting you apart from the rest of the world, because they don't know what we know now. And you're seeing it now. Continue, preach up.
And have given to us the ministry of reconciliation. Mm-hmm. To wit, that Yahweh was in the Messiah.
Now look, watch this now. Yahweh was in the Messiah.
Reconciling the world unto himself.
Reconciling the world unto himself. Mm-hmm. See? Now, when you understand what we're talking about, you and I will be becoming one with him, becoming one in spirit and in understanding. Now, in the age to come, we're going to be being perfected in that knowledge and understanding, becoming more one with him to where you are going to be him. I was going to say that way. And then he's going to, at the end of everything, come to that point, then he's going to submit it back to the Father, and the Father might be all in all. Now I'll be back in the pure spirit. Okay. Now, Yahweh is eternal. Mm-hmm. Yahweh alone took all shape and form. That has a beginning, and it has an end. That's not eternal. That's number Yahweh. That means that body's going to go back into pure spirit. See? Now, we're going to be in him when that happens. They're going to make you one with him. That's why the Messiah then said that we, together, will decide what we're going to do next. Because we're going to become Yahweh. And we're going to become Yahweh before we're going to become Yahweh, and then become Yahweh. And then at that time, we're going to decide what we're going to do next. We got to talk about the spirit that we have in it at that time. So now if you're following on now. You see how all these things testify to the Messiah. Now, look at your children down there. They were in a death-like situation. They were slaves, they were in bondage down there. And you're always saying, Moses and Aaron down there to deliver them out of it. That's when the law and the prophets come down to deliver them. So they had to hear the gospel. They had to hear what Moses and Aaron said in order to be delivered from there. But the devil come by death, come by resurrection now. And they were raised up and they came up to the waters of the Red Sea into the wilderness. They were delivered from that. They were set free from that. That's why they sang the song of victory. So they overcome that. Now, you and I, we now praise Joshua by showing how he came in and fulfilled the law and the prophets. That's the way we give praise to him. And that's the way we give glory to him. And when you give glory to him, you give glory to the Father. Because the Father did the work through him. See? And it's Yahweh that's speaking through mankind. He knows each one, is him speaking there. That's why everything that's happening, everything that's going on is being orchestrated by Yahweh. And that's because he declared the end from the beginning. So he knows what's going on. See? Now, sometimes I'm missing something, forget something. You know?
Can you bring Acts the 12th chapter into this?
Oh, good point. So when the Messiah raised from the dead back here on the third day, and what did he do?
Fulfilled the law and the prophets.
See? So now, if we look back at the Israel back here, they went through the divine word of Red Sea, that was the way they killed the lamb to death. He went to the Red Sea, that's the water.
Right.
Raising the wolf. How long are they going to be out there?
40 years.
Well, how do you know that stuff?
One day, 3 years.
Well, you have to know it. When Yahweh caused that case to bomb him out, what happened to him? He went 3 days during
two.
Right. And warned him.
Preach deliverance.
And how long did he preach to him? 3 day journey to Nineveh?
Yeah.
Okay.
From the city.
Okay. Never mind. Okay. When you read there in Jonah, you read in the third chapter, you read that they went into Nineveh and warned the people.
Yeah,
for 40 days.
Mm-hmm.
He warned.
Right.
After his spirit with his death and burial and ran in the fish. Then he went and warned them for 40 days.
Mm-hmm. Right.
See, so when the Messiah, when he raised from the dead, he got period to be established for a period of 40 days. So you got to be 40 days to live in the wilderness, 30 years. To Noah, he had a piece of one of the people when he warned, as he preached to them, warned them. The preaching of the gospel was baptizing them. See, and those that believed, they went into the ark, they were then saved. Mm-hmm. See, and it was in the ark. Now, it rained, how long did it rain?
40 days.
40 days, 40 nights, see. So blood, water, spirit, 40. Blood, water, spirit, 40. You see, all the way down through there, see. How long was Adam in the garden?
40 days.
Yeah, but we ain't going to ask so long. But the point what I'm trying to get you to see is it's got to be repeated over and over again. That's what makes the scripture be true. That's what makes the Bible be validated and be accurate. When you see how accurate it is by seeing these things repeated over precisely. See? So after Jonah came out, he preached, we were born to people 40 days. See? And then you look out here, the children that came out of the Red Sea, and they wandered in the wilderness for 40 years. See? And you see now what's happening. Red Sea, it's got to come all the way down that way. And it's repeating over and over again. That's proven the divine authenticity, unerring accuracy of the scripture. How it repeats over and over again. And that's because you have the confidence you have in this in the Messiah.
Yeah.
Did I get covered with you something? Did you ask about it?
No, not yet. Acts the 12th chapter?
Oh, no.
You're getting there.
Okay. So now, after the Messiah raised from the dead, and you've seen the Jews that, if you read some of the other epistles, you read that they were very skeptical about his resurrection. See? So what Yahweh does, he waits. So now go give me Acts 12 and 1. You get my look at it now.
Acts 12 and 1. Mm-hmm. Now about that time, Herod the king stretched forth his hands to vex certain of the assembly.
Mm-hmm.
And he killed James, the brother of John.
About that time. About what time?
Yeah. And he killed James, the brother of John.
He killed James. One of the three was up in the mountain. Joe James, read.
With a sword.
Uh-huh.
And because he saw it pleased the Jews.
Sorry, because he saw it pleased the Jews.
He proceeded further to take Peter also.
Uh-huh.
Then were the days of unleavened bread.
The days of unleavened bread. That means April. Mm-hmm. April 14th. Days of unleavened bread.
And when he apprehended him, he put him in prison.
He put him in prison.
And delivered him to four quadrants of soldiers,
mm-hmm,
to keep him, intending after Easter to bring him forth of the people. Four quadrants of soldiers to keep him, intending after Easter to bring him forth.
After the Passover. Listen, folks. How we are so gullible it really baffles my mind. They're teaching you that a rabbit, and they talk about a chicken, and then you got eggs. They decorate the eggs all on it, and they play hide and seek. They got all kinds of games around it. They ain't got nothing to do with the resurrection. And it's tradition and custom that got to come down to the
egg. Take it easy.
See? Now, it's okay if you're going to fix me a meal with stuff. That's fine. but it's not to be done the way it is by a teacher to be. See, you haven't ever seen a rabbit give birth to an egg. Chicken or egg, you want?
Chocolate egg.
You see the calamity that they have with that kind of stuff. Okay, go ahead and read that.
Fifth verse. Peter, therefore, was kept in prison. But prayer was made without ceasing of the assembly.
What is this now? They're praying for him to be delivered from prison.
And when Herod would have brought him forth, The same night Peter was sleeping between two soldiers, bound with two chains.
Bound with two chains.
And keeping before the door kept the prison.
And kept the prison. And was he bound, doors were closed, and he was bound in the prison. Read.
And behold, the angel of Yahweh came upon him.
An angel came back. It's like an angel came back to the earth. You got to see an angel come down here. Read. But then now, the time of this is 10 years from the time Messiah was raised. Was raised from the dead. So he's confirming that 10 years complete. Read.
And a light shined in the prison.
And a light shined in the prison.
And he smote Peter on the side and raised him up, saying,
wrote him on the side. See, remember the Messiah, be pierced in the side. He says, wrote him on the side for you.
Arise up quickly.
Rise up quickly.
And his chains fell off his hand.
And his chains fell off his hand.
And the angel said unto him, gird thyself and bind on thy sandals. Mm-hmm. And so he did. So and he said unto him, cast thy garment about thee.
Cast thy garment about
thee. And follow me.
And follow me.
And so he went out.
That means that the angel came down, unlocked the door, did it, and he said, I'm following him. So he's going to be following the angel. Following the spirit of the cow, children follow the cow out of the land of Egypt. Mm-hmm. See, you're following him. Okay, read now when the Messiah came along. He said, told his son, follow me. He said, go before me. He said, follow me. Read.
And he went out and followed him. Mm-hmm. And wist not that it was true which was done by the angel.
Yeah, he's believing what's happening to him. Read.
But thought he saw a vision.
But thought he saw a vision.
When they were past the first and the second ward.
Went through the first, coming through the most holy place, down the holy place, coming through the second ward. Read.
They came unto an iron gate.
They came to an iron gate.
That leadeth them to the city.
The prisoner you set by the battle.
Right.
So you see him come to the So you come on down, read.
Which opened to them of his own accord. Mm-hmm. And they went out and passed on through one street.
Went past first street.
And forthwith the angel departed from him.
And then the angel departed from him. Now he's standing in front of the house where they're praying for him. Okay, read.
Now when Peter was come to himself, he said, now I know of a surety that Yahshua has sent his angel and hath delivered me out of the hand of Herod.
Now he's convinced that Yahweh raised Yahshua from the dead, because he delivered him from the prison. Read.
And from all the acceptation of the people of the Jews. Mm-hmm. And when he had done a considerable thing, he came to the house of Mary.
He came to the house of Mary. Another Mary now, see.
The mother of John.
The mother of John.
Whose surname was Mark. Mm-hmm. Where many were gathered together praying.
This is John Mark's mother. Okay, read.
And as Peter knocked at the door of the gate, a damsel came to hearken, named Rhoda.
Knocking at the door. A woman. Read.
A woman. And when she...
A damsel came to the door.
Yes.
Can you read?
And when she knew Peter's voice...
She knew Peter's voice.
She opened not the gate for gladness.
She didn't open it because she went back in to tell him what gate that what happened. Peter's out in there praying for him. He's coming back. She's coming back. Say, hey, he's at the door. He's at the door. See, remember when the Messiah raised from the dead, Mary Magdalene was at the door.
Yes,
and the angel told him to go to tell his brother.
Yeah.
So that's what's happening now. She's going to go tell the rest of them that he's risen. Read on.
But ran in and told how Peter stood before the gate.
Ran in and said, Peter said, they were praying for him, but now he was at the door. See, read.
And they said unto her, thou art mad.
They didn't believe that.
But she constantly affirmed that it was even so.
Uh-huh.
Then said they, it is his angel.
It is his angel. Now, they said, now it's his angel. Okay, here we go.
But Peter continued knocking. And when they had opened the door and saw him, they were astonished.
They were astonished at it.
But he, beckoning unto them with his hand to hold their peace, declared unto them how Yahshua had brought him out of prison.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, go show these things unto James and to the brethren. And he departed and went into another place.
Right. So you see now, that was a confirmation of Messiah's death, burial, and resurrection.
Right.
And here he's coming out, goes in there, and gets at the door. So when Messiah raised the dead, he's got to have a woman got to be at the tomb. Why is that? Because when Messiah put, when you always put out at the feet, when you decide about that three about and get the woman out, then when Adam woke up from his operation. then he was able to see, who did he see for? He sees Mary.
A woman.
That's repeating over again, convincing that that was the same Yahweh. This is the day of the meal. For here he is now. Peter gets out now. He's ready to preach the gospel now.
That's it.
He went through it. Yes, brother, look himself. Mm-hmm. See, that's what happens to you now when you understand what's happened to you. We were dead. We did not know. We did not understand until Yahweh. See? Cause you to understand. See that little glimmer of light in you? See? That little glimmer of light. When you see that glimmer of light, you see all the glory. Yahweh is really great, folks.
Yeah.
And as you start seeing more and more of that, the more you're going to be able to give glory and praise to him because of what he did. Nothing. See it. There's so much in this thing to see it. See it. You went all the way back in the pure spirit, showing Yahweh took on shape and form. That was him in the bosom of the Father. See? That was him being baptized in Yahweh. Then you guys come on down here and show him being baptized in the Lord. They were baptized. This repeated over and over again. And
right.
That's supposed to bring you, bring a point to you that you be convinced that that had to be the Messiah. Mm-hmm. And when that's confirmed in you, then you give glory to him. See? That's what it's all about for you. See? I hope we got something out of what we said.
Yeah.
So we'll come back out and say this, and we'll see what we get into next.
I was told to bring up this class list again. Whether you made a change to it or not, excuse me, still come up here and initial it, that you looked at it. That way, Dr. Schaff can go ahead and make a copy of the updated list. So if you haven't initialed it, please come up here and initial it, okay? Make sure you get all your personal items that you came in with. And be careful out there. There's a lot of drunk people on Easter. Be careful. Good Catholics. Good Catholics. Get drunk. So, let us stand and be dismissed with doxology, please. Now to him that is able to keep you from falling, that you fall us before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. The only wise, the only of our Savior, through Yahshua Messiah, our Sovereign, with on glory, majesty, dominion of power, both for all time, now and ever, let us all say.
Hallelujah.